I have a wonderful electronic invention I want you to see. It looks something like you.
Welcome to the second chapter.
It is good to see you back. Now I don't have to hunt you down.
In this chapter, we are going to create a custom orientation on the curve that will allow us to have the train leaning into a turn and also follow its slope. We are going to use the super formula to create an interesting shape for the rail itself and finally isolate tunnel segments for further processing. In the last section, we isolated the important area of the terrain and also a subdivided version of the curve that sticks to the surface. That's where we want to pick up and continue the work on the curve that was feeded into the system. In the first section, I want to find the base height for the rail and also categorize if a segment of the rail is either leaning to the left or to the right. Let's start with the height. My starting point is going to be the surface curve that is in direct contact with the terrain. I am using its position for two purposes. First, I just need the X and Z positions regardless of the Y axis. The starting point for that will be defined in this wrangle, surface to rail level. Fairly straightforward, I am setting the position component of the Y axis to a fixed value coming from a channel. By doing that, I have another way to control the outcome. I now have a slider that defines what the starting height of the rail will be. To get a better idea what a good value might be, you can template the prep terrain slice. And that is roughly what I am after. When the terrain is somewhat flat, I want the rail to hover a bit above, right here at the beginning of the curve. That's where I want to set that base distance between curve and terrain. In my example, I found 15 to be a good level. For what I have in mind, I want the curve to be converted into a line to get primitives between the points. But as you can see here, there are quite a lot of them. I say they are too many, since these points are also going to be the basis for potential placements of towers and bridges. So let me go back to that resample and increase the length to 3. Given the size of the scene, that is still enough but limits the amount of tests we need later on. With that done, I want to make sure that the normals point along the curve, the tangent of it. For that, you can simply throw down a polyframe node. Here we can activate and name the tangent that gets calculated. Just type an N for the normal attribute, and we can directly see and work with it.
What are you talking about? I can't see sh**.
The issue here is that the default visualization is a bit small. We are often looking at it from farther away, so it makes sense to turn these up a bit. But that was just the base height of the curve. Now we want to introduce different slope levels relative to the terrain. We want to lerp the curve. In that context, lerp means we find a point that is somewhere in the transition between two different positions. To control that, you provide a value between 0 and 1. The value 0 would be the starting position, in our case, on the curve at rail level. With a value of 1, you reach the position on the surface curve. The only difference between both points is the Y coordinate. Now let's see how that translates into VEX. This snippet will look a bit more complex, but it is simple if you break it down. First, I want to get the distance between the point on the one curve to the same on the other. That means I need the distance function, and I can simply use it P for the current point. Let me first write this one so that you can see it. It comes from the second input, so I use the point function with it PTNum, which asks the point with the same point number for its position. But since the point function is used to address all possible attributes, it does not know what it will return by itself. It needs some context to figure that out. When you simply fill a vector variable with it, it does know what to do. It should return a vector. When used inside of a function, like you see here, it does not know that. That's why we put a vector cast around the statement, and we are fine again. I want this distance to be the transition factor for the lerp. So I need to normalize the value. I like to use the fit function for that. Provide the distance and remap the values going from 0 to whatever I put into the scale channel, and that range is now 0 to 1. And finally, I simply set the position to the built-in lerp function, using again the current position and the position of the second curve. The transition factor is, as I said, the normalized distance but I multiply it with an additional value. That will give me more control on the result. Let's generate the two parameters and try to find good values for them. Maybe we start with a 10 on the scale, which means when the surface is 10 units away from the rail curve, we have a 1 in the distance variable. When we now play with the lerp slider, the curve moves closer to the surface, but it does so mainly where we have bigger drops. Everywhere else it reacts slower to the change. With a distance beyond 10 and the lerp slider of 1, it would go down to touch the surface. For the result, I want this change to happen if we encounter bigger valleys. So I use a bigger value for the scale, maybe 100 will do the trick, and a good value should be somewhere in the middle for the lerp itself. This reflects the surface itself, so this will make the curve very jagged. To counter that, we create a first smooth before we even feed the surface curve into the wrangle. We don't intend to touch the surface, so we can have it be smoothed out directly at this stage. Again, given the size of the scene, this value can be a lot bigger. We only need it for the distance, as you have seen. When we have a curve that could work for your needs and you have a lerped result, it may be helpful to put in another smooth right after the wrangle, just in case you got some sharp edges left. But even if I leave it at 10, the result on this seems to be fine. Now it gets a bit more interesting. Orientation. I want the train to lean into a given curve, but in relation to how strong that curve is. Again, the initial approach is a bit older and I wanted to use a wrangle to find the orientation itself. Don't worry, we won't do that, since we now have a node for that, but I quickly jump through the idea. After we have an orientation, I want to split the curve into two groups, the parts where the train should lean to the left or to the right. This I will do in a wrangle with a simple trick. First, I want to look at a point that is offset from the current point. That offset comes in first with a channel. Let's say I use an offset of 6. When I am on point number 2, I want to do some testing with point 8. I want to get the normal from that specific point, using the current point number plus the offset. I also need the position of that point. For the test I want to do, I need the two positions. Let's name the first test 1, and I want it to be at the offset position, but pushed into a direction. That direction is, for times, the normalized cross product of an up vector and the normal. The second point does the same, but with a reversed cross product. Now, for those that don't use vex often, this might be one of these times where your brain goes,
"Dude, are you serious? I want to create epic VFX shots and not become a hacker. I am out of here."
It is sometimes not easy to grasp what happens, especially if you don't see the purpose behind it. That's when you can add in some lines for debugging. Testing your code. Here you created positions which may or may not be where you expect them to be. If you are not sure if they are, or you don't quite get what happened to it after a fancy cross product, just add the points into your scene to get the feedback you need. Add point with the position, and now you see exactly what happens. The main curve now has a point on each side, always staying in the exact distance to the original point. When I increase the offset, each point creates the two points farther away. That also means that you don't have any test points at the initial few points. And the last points create false test points, since it tries to go beyond the available points. I give you a possible workaround in a few, but in this case we can simply ignore that shortcoming. It will basically come to the same conclusion as if we would build in a safeguard. But let's do the test itself first. It is pretty straightforward. I want to see which of the two points is closer to get an idea in which direction the curve is leaning. So first we create a dist 1 and 2, which uses the distance function again. At P and the test positions, now we just check which of the distances is smaller than the other. If the distance to the first position is smaller, which would be the point on the right side, I put the point in a group called lean right. And I also set its color to red. I then do the opposite with the other case. This group is called lean left and uses another color for easy debugging going forward. If this is the curve as a whole, viewed from the top, this created points on the right, always as a first point, and then another point on the left side, since we set the minus in front of the cross product. If I look at a section, zoomed in, my current point could be the red circle while I have the two points in front of me. If the curve is making a right turn, The blue point is now closer to the initial point. I don't have any idea of the degree yet, but here I just want to categorize the sections. Now we can also get rid of the two add points. To the small workaround for the two ends of the curve, the points in the beginning do not matter at all, since point 0 simply looks at, for example, point 6 for reference. There are simply no test points needed before point 6. The point in the end, however, should simply not be allowed to look farther than the max point number. But this is, however, relevant. If we have a closed curve, maybe we want our rail to be a circle. So the last points need to look for the first points rather than go beyond the max amount of points. One way to accomplish that would be to save that ptnum plus offset into a variable. And then if the point number is bigger than the amount of points minus 1 and minus the offset. The minus 1 here is very important and a common mistake. That takes care of the fact that points start with 0 in their numbers. NumPt, however, starts to count with 1. But if that's the case, we want to be target something different. And that's the offset itself, minus the difference of the amount and the points. That way the last point, with an offset of 1, would look at point 0, and with that close the circle. Houdini's points can be seen like an array. Being able to repeat an array or a list is an important tool. And you will need something like this again and again.
You heard the man. Write that down somewhere.
We use something similar for the train later, but on a not closed curve you don't really need it in this project. Without it, the last points try to get the test positions for points that do not exist. So the point function returns an empty vector for both points, which then have the same distance. In short, they are just ignored for either of the lean groups, but it is still good to be aware of that. The value on the offset has an influence on the borders between the two groups. Here you can also shift what you would regard as part of the turn, because we will take each group section and apply its own role. But we come to that later. First, again, some cleanup. We have reached a good point for an output. This is the not yet fully oriented curve. As a last thing, let's use another way of debugging the curve by copying something on it. That's what we will do later with the train, so this will show us how that might look. Simply create a box and make it bigger in Y and slightly bigger in X. The box now goes into a copy to PointSop. It will pick up the color, giving us a better view on what's going on. And as you can see, we do have some initial orienting already, but that just comes from the normals being the curve's tangent. What we don't have is the point following the slope. That, on the other hand, is due to the curve's tangent, since we created it before the lerp. Creating another polyframe again would give us a result to work with, but it would be not good enough for the train. So we need proper orientation, but that's part of the next clip.
What he wants to tell you with that is you better go and subscribe to the channel. How would you live with yourself if you would miss it? And while you are at it, hit the bell icon.